Okay, good afternoon. On behalf of the American Association for Cancer Research, I want to thank you all for joining us today to a special briefing by the fellows of the AACR Academy, Saving Lives in the New Era of Precision Medicine. My name is Carlos Arteaga, and I'm the immediate past president of the AACR and director of the Center for Cancer Targeted Therapies at Vanderbilt University, where I also direct the breast cancer program. The AACR and its more than 35,000 members residing in the U.S. and 96 countries around the world are dedicated to the prevention and cure of all cancers through research, education, communication, collaboration, and research funding. We are pleased that Representative Jackie Speier is with us to kick off this event. Congresswoman Speier has represented California's 14th Congressional District, which includes portions of San Francisco, since 2008. During her tenure in Congress, she has shown a strong commitment to ensuring quality health care for all Americans. Congresswoman Speier has been an unwavering supporter of medical research by championing funding for the National Institutes of Health. She has also been a champion for cancer survivorship issues and tobacco control, particularly efforts focused on preventing tobacco initiation in youth and protecting youth from marketing of tobacco products. I would like now to turn it over to Congresswoman Speier to make a few remarks.
Thank you, Doctor. This is a standing room only crowd, so they recognize talent when they see it. I'm honored to be joining all of you, and Dr. Arteaga, thank you for that introduction. I also want to thank my colleagues, Congressman McKinley and Carson, for their engagement in this issue area. And Dr. Foti, Dr. Baselga, and the American Association of Cancer Research for coordinating this important event. We're also joined by panelists Dr. Joe Hanselman, Dr. Joan Brugge, Dr. Eric Rubin, and forgive me for being a little territorial, but also Nobel laureate, rock star, and past AACR president, Dr. Elizabeth Blackburn from University of California, San Francisco. This is a talented group, and it reminds me of when John F. Kennedy was engaged in socializing in the White House and had a number of great leaders there, and he said, there's never been so much talent in one room since Thomas Jefferson dined alone. I sort of think that we are somewhat in the same category here today. I want to first start off by talking about an endangered species of bird. It may sound odd, me wanting to talk about that, but it's a goose. And it's a goose that lays golden eggs. And that goose is the National Institute of Health. It lays golden eggs over and over again in terms of good jobs, longer and healthier lives, and lower healthcare spending. But it is in jeopardy of losing that endangered species of bird because we have cut in real-time dollars over the last 10 years 25% of the NIH budget, 25%. And while we still lead in terms of overall research and patents, China is gaining on us very quickly and has eclipsed Japan as number two. So if current trends continue and we don't address the decline in funding for NIH, in fact, China will become number one within the decade. In the Bay Area, we have benefited immensely from the research investments. And our district is testament to the tremendous advances that can be made through combined efforts of government funding of basic research, top-rated institutions of higher learning, such as UCSF, UC Berkeley, and Stanford, a venture capital industry that's willing to take risks and invest in promising new technologies, and an industry committed to developing medications that advance the treatment of life-threatening diseases. Now, just think about this. Where would we be today if certain research had not been funded? No one would have thought of a bacteria from a hot springs in Yosemite would be the underpinning of genetics, or that a glowing jellyfish would pave the way for advances in biomedical science. We must continue investing in basic research because we don't know where the next discovery will come from. That Bay Area's innovation economy depends on federal government's fundamental investment in basic science. Now, I can boast the fact that the top recipient of NIH funding is none other than UCSF. I want to keep it that way. But I do, in fact, want to see other institutions of higher learning across this country, many of them in the districts of members that you represent, gain that kind of access as well. It's funding like that at NIH, which led to the dramatic improvements in the treatment of many diseases, including the 2008 vaccine for HPV, which can cause cancer of the cervix, as we know. The first FDA-approved treatment for the most common type of skin cancer, basal cell carcinoma, in 2012, and most recently, clinical trials this year in an alternative for breast cancer chemotherapy treatment. So, we don't need to go on and on, but we know that NIH funding, basic research, is key to saving lives and extending lives, and we have an incredible panel of experts today who are going to share their wisdom with us. So thank you very much all for being here.
Thank you, Representative Speier, for being here and for your support. I also want to take a moment to thank Congressman David McKinley of West Virginia and Congressman Andre Carson of Indiana for their support for this event and for the leadership in supporting NIH funding. This spring, they led a bipartisan Dear Colleague letter signed by 170 members of the House that called on Congress to fund the NIH at $32 billion or above in fiscal year 2016. So why are we here today? We're here to talk about cancer research and specifically precision medicine, which is taking center stage thanks to the President's Precision Medicine Initiative. Our scientific leaders who are here today will highlight the advancements being made in precision medicine and the importance of federal funding for cancer research through the NIH and the NCI. It is an extraordinarily exciting time for cancer research. We're now able to prevent, detect, diagnose, and treat this devastating disease with ever-increasing sophistication and success. During the 25 years that I have been a physician scientist, I have witnessed firsthand how scientific advances impact the lives of patients in ways that would have been unimaginable only a few short years ago. Precision medicine lies at the heart of the excitement in cancer research and treatment today. At its simplest, precision medicine is an approach for disease treatment and prevention that takes into account individual variability of genes, environment, and lifestyle for each person. Cancer research has been leading the charge to put precision medicine into practice for several years now, as scientists are increasingly developing treatments and technologies that can precisely target the unique characteristics of an individual's cancer. These discoveries, coupled with the launch of the President's Bold Precision Medicine Initiative, will undoubtedly generate the scientific evidence needed to propel the concept of precision medicine into everyday clinical practice for many diseases, not only cancer. We in the cancer research community are hopeful that through the President's initiative, precision medicine approaches being pioneered by many cancer investigators will rise to the forefront of our national dialogue on health. You will hear more in a moment about this important initiative from a member of the President's own staff, and also hear more about what precision medicine advancements truly mean for cancer patients and their loved ones. In addition to advances being made in patient care, it is important to understand how we have reached to the point we're here today. This did not happen by just luck and accident. Continued progress against cancer will require support of the full spectrum of cancer research, from laboratory science to translational research, clinical research, and eventually clinical practice. In other words, from bench to bedside and back to the bench. It is through basic science research in the laboratory that we can foster an even deeper understanding of the biology of cancer so that we may continue to expedite the development of new drugs and treatment strategies for preventing, diagnosing, and treating this collection of 200 diseases that we call cancer. Thanks to the groundbreaking discoveries made by scientists such as Dr. Blackburn and Dr. Brugge, whom you will hear from today, we understand more about how and why cancer develops and why it is so incredibly complex. Similarly, because of the translational and clinical advances made by physician scientists in academia like Dr. Baselga and those working in industry like Dr. Rubin, discoveries are becoming realities for patients in the form of new therapies and innovative treatment approaches. It is because of the tireless work of these individuals and cancer investigators worldwide that cancer is no longer, and I want to emphasize this, is no longer an automatic death sentence. There are now more than 14.5 million cancer survivors in the US alone. The cancer death rate has declined by 1% each year for the past two decades, resulting in more than 1 million lives saved. We owe much of this success to the federal investment that Congress has made for decades in the NIH and the NCI. Support for these agencies has enabled investigators to decipher many of cancer's complexities, leading to improved care for cancer patients. Importantly, NIH funding also bolsters our economy by putting dollars back into local communities at the rate of $2.2 for every dollar spent in research. And not only does this funding directly support the nation's economy, but it also contributes to the NIH's status as one of the primary drivers behind the United States' global leadership in science and innovation. This crown jewel of the federal government is the envy of countries around the world that are now seeking to emulate our success by increasing their own investments in science and medicine. However, despite this time of great opportunity and momentum, we find that our ability to deliver the promise of science and precision medicine breakthroughs to patients is in jeopardy, and that our global leadership in this arena is similarly at risk. The NIH and NCI budgets remain below what they were in fiscal year 2010 in nominal terms because of cuts in recent years. When taking into account medical inflation, NIH's ability to fund life-saving research has been diminished by nearly 25% since 2003. Now it's the time to hold back funding. It's not the time to hold back funding for cancer research, as there is still much more work to be done. There's urgent need to put federal funding for the NIH back on a path for predictable growth, especially since cancer represents a growing healthcare challenge in the nation. Just a few statistics. Nearly 1.7 million Americans will receive a cancer diagnosis this year, and more than 589,000 will die from cancer in 2015. Cancer is projected soon to become the number one killer of Americans, and in a decade, it is expected to be the number one killer globally, unless we take steps to stem this tide. These statistics are reflected in death rates that remain extraordinarily high for certain cancers, such as pancreatic, liver, lung, brain, and ovarian cancer. There's an enormous sense of urgency, and now is the time to address the looming cancer crisis in America. As we will hear about today, scientific momentum has ushered in this new era of precision medicine. In this new era, there is renewed hope that with even more effective interventions, we can save even more lives from cancer. You will be hearing more about such innovations today from Dr. Rubin. However, this will only be possible with unwavering and bipartisan commitment from Congress and the administration to invest in our country's remarkable productive medical research enterprise. We're confident that this is possible and are encouraged by recent developments on Capitol Hill. First, we were pleased to see the House Appropriations Subcommittee on Labor propose a $1.1 billion increase for the NIH just this morning, in the first markup of a House labor bill in more than 3 years. This is an exciting step forward. We also commend the House Energy and Commerce Committee for its work on the 21st Century Cures Initiative and the Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, Help Innovations for Healthier American Initiative. The CURES legislation provides significant resources for the NIH and the FDA and would help propel precision medicine in a meaningful way. Now I would like to introduce the first of our distinguished group of speakers who will describe to you some of the amazing work that is taking place in the field of cancer research today. First is Dr. José Baselga. He's the physician in chief at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York City. He's also the current president of the American Association for Cancer Research. Dr. Baselga is one of the founding editors in chief of the AACR high impact journal Cancer Discovery. He's an international renowned physician scientist whose clinical and translational research in the area of growth factor receptors and cell signaling has resulted in the development of multiple drugs in breast cancer. His research is and has been devoted to identifying mechanisms of resistance and the development of novel anti-cancer drugs for the treatment of patients with breast cancer worldwide. José, please, you have the podium.
Thank you, Carlos. Good morning, Congresswoman Speier. Thank you for being here. And thank you, everybody. This is really standing room. By the way, if you're interested, there's one more chair here. Maybe somebody can grab it. It is a real pleasure to be here today with all of you. And I'd like to expand upon some of the comments that Dr. Arteaga has made. We are right now at the historical moment in our fight against cancer. After many, many decades of scientific progress and billions of dollars of federal research support for this fight against this disease. And now what for the first time, we truly understand what cancer is. And we know that cancer is a disease of the genome. Now, it is complicated, but not that much. It's less than what we had anticipated. Basically, every single cell in our body, and we have up to a trillion of cells, has 20,000 genes. And these genes, they need to replicate every time that a cell divides. So imagine the opportunities that occur for something to go wrong. So if there is a single cell division that one of these genes replicates in the wrong way, these genomic alterations that we called mutations, if they occur in a gene that is important for some certain cellular functions, that can turn a normal cell into cancer. Today, thank you to the federally supported Tumor Genome Atlas Initiative and others around the world, we have been able to identify all the genomic alterations that are present in every tumor type. It's an amazing atlas. We know what is driving the majority of the tumors. We call it the genomic landscape of the tumor. It's like a map. The same way that you have maps of countries, maps of the world, we have maps of the genomic mutations of every single tumor. And therefore, we are in a historical moment. We were never so close to understand what is going on and what's driving our number one killer. So now, not only we have the genomic alteration, but years later, thanks to tremendous technological advances and scientific discoveries, we have the capacity to sequence, to analyze the genome of every single tumor from every single patient. So it's no longer an enterprise that has to be done for specific tumors. We can sequence the tumors real time, in very short time, in our clinics. So we can identify the gene alterations that are driving these tumors, and we can choose therapies that are attacking those mutations that we call them driver mutations. They are mutations that are responsible for a tumor to grow. And that's the concept of precision medicine that has been put forward by President Obama and by the scientific community. It's very simple. It's to sequence the tumors or other diseases, but in this case in cancer, to sequence the tumors, to identify the driver mutations, and then to choose therapies a la carte. So instead of choosing therapies just by empirical means, just because that's the way we do things, we are now for the first time having the capacity to choose treatments because we know exactly what are we trying to achieve. As Carlos has mentioned, and like himself, I am a physician scientist and have been fortunate enough to lead the first clinical trials with two drugs in breast cancer. One is called Herceptin that targets HER2-positive disease. You're familiar with this drug for sure. And then the other one is called Perjeta that also targets HER2-positive disease. Herceptin and Perjeta and other drugs have turned in less than 10 years a lethal form of breast cancer into one that is highly, highly curable in a very short time. In fact, the FDA approved last year the combination of both drugs, Herceptin and Perjeta, prior to surgery. So can you imagine this? In less than 10 years, patients dying with times of survival that were counted in months. And now we give these two therapies before surgery, so that we are going to be making chemotherapy unnecessary. So is this an exception? Is Herceptin and Perjeta just outliers into our field of cancer therapies? The answer is absolutely no. Just in breast cancer, up to 70% of breast tumors, 70%, have genomic alterations that we could treat today with new targeted therapies that we already have available. 70%. I keep the number in my head all the time. So I would like to give you some examples on how this would look like or how this initiative could look like. And I'll go back to my own institution. There are many other institutions that are doing similar initiatives. So at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, we established last year the Center for Molecular Oncology and have launched an unparalleled effort to sequence every single tumor from every patient that has advanced cancer. So last year, we sequenced 10,000 tumors. This year, we are sequencing, we're on our way to sequence 12,000, and very rapidly will escalate to 20,000. The results of the sequencing of these tumors not only go to the patient's medical chart, but also to the patients themselves. In parallel with the sequencing, we have launched an all-out effort to initiate clinical studies with novel therapies that are aimed at targeting the majority of these mutations. So today, on a daily basis, patients that had no hope may benefit from some of these therapies. I'd like to recall one case that you may be aware of because it was on the cover of the Time magazine not too long ago, a patient of ours. This is a patient that had a very rare tumor type that involved the brain. And the patient came to see us as a last resort. We identified that her tumor, incredibly rare, it is called Adam-Chester disease, had a BRAF mutation. This patient was, the tumor was sequenced, we found the mutation. We offered her, as part of a clinical study, a BRAF inhibitor that is already approved for melanoma. And basically, in 1 week, the tumor was gone. The patient is still totally asymptomatic more than 2 years after therapy was begun. And we were able to bring from all over the country patients with this disease that are now benefiting from this approach. To date, we have treated 18 patients, and they're all doing incredibly well. So this is why, and we could go on and on, and that's not the point, but this is why we do support at the AACR the principle that sequencing of tumors should be made available to all patients with advanced cancer. These tests are not expensive when compared to other diagnostic tests that we use in the clinic, and we feel strongly that they should be reimbursed. Similar to our approach, the NCI has launched the MATCH trial open to patients nationwide. And this is the type of initiative that we should be very proud to support and to encourage. Now, we are not done. Our road towards precision medicine has only started. We need to develop combination therapies very much like what led to the successful development of therapies for HIV. We need to move from treating patients with advanced disease to the concept of early detection of cancer. In an amazing breakthrough, we now have the capacity to identify tumor DNA in the blood of our patients. We call this approach the concept of liquid biopsy. So imagine not having to go in and do tumor biopsies, but rather take blood and be able to identify the mutations there and the presence of tumor. So this concept of liquid biopsies, it opens the gates to the concept of early cancer diagnosis at a time when the majority of tumors could be cured. We also are beginning to understand that tumors evolved over time under therapy, and they escape from the effects of therapy to survive. Therefore, we will need to continuously interrogate these tumors in order to predict the best treatment as the disease evolves. And finally, immune therapies. You will hear today, and you are familiar with the concept already, that immune therapies are one of the most exciting discoveries for the treatment of cancer. Precision medicine will enable us to predict which tumors will respond to these therapies. So I hope I have been able to convey to you our excitement and at the same time, the urgent need to bring all these new approaches to our patients. And also to realize once more that all this promise has been made as a result of the NIH and the NCI. So as we come closer to a cure for cancer, this is not the time to let go, but rather the time to invest heavily in our future and that of our patients with cancer. Thank you very much. So I'd like now to move on, and I'd like to introduce Dr. Joe Handelsman. Dr. Handelsman is the Associate Director for Science at the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, appointed by President Obama and confirmed by the Senate in June of 2014. Dr. Handelsman helps to advise President Obama on the implications of science for the nation, ways in which science can inform U.S. policy, and on federal efforts in support of scientific research. Prior to joining the OSTP, Dr. Handelsman was a Howard Hughes Medical Institute professor and the Frederick Phineas Ross professor in the Department of Molecular, Cellular, and Developmental Biology at Yale University. Dr. Handelsman, thank you so much for being here today.
Well, thank you, Dr. Baselga, and thank you all for being here. It's a real pleasure to represent the President's initiative on precision medicine, which he announced on January 30th. Many of you may have heard the announcement or read about it, with the mission that he stated, and I quote, to enable a new era of medicine through research, technology, and policies that empower patients, researchers, and providers to work together toward development of individualized treatments. And so you can hear from that that it's a very broad initiative with many components, and I'll focus today on the near-term movement that we're making. But I should also say it's a very young initiative, and so we're just at the beginning, and pending congressional support for it, we hope to advance more rapidly next year. So this initiative is multi-agency and multi-unit. It's a collaboration among the White House, the VA, the Department of Defense, and HHS, and a number of units within Health and Human Services. And it also uses the patient as partner. So it's not only a partnership among government agencies, but also with citizens. And we've been working very hard with the citizen stakeholders, as well as researchers and physicians, to develop the vision that the President has asked us to pursue. Precision medicine isn't that new. So there's been a lot written about it since the President's announcement. And one of the comments that was made that I think is worth addressing is that it's way off in the future. Precision medicine is now, and it has been, part of medicine for many, many years. And an early example is blood transfusions, where the biochemistry of the person who was being transfused was matched to the blood that was being introduced. That's a simple example. It's an old one that we're all familiar with, but it's much more highly tailored and customized to the individual than many of the treatments that we experience in medicine today. So what we hope is that we're now entering an era that has offered us the tools and the capability to apply that kind of precision, that kind of tailoring of medical treatment to the individual. And a number of things have changed. Patients are very activist today, and they have a very strong interest in partnering with their physicians and with the medical enterprise and with researchers to advance their own medicine as well as medicine more broadly. We also have reached an entirely new level of data science. We have the capacity to collect and manage, store, and analyze data in ways that were unprecedented or unheard of a decade ago. We also have medical technologies that, as have been already mentioned, have really changed the face of medicine with DNA technology, biochemical technologies, metabolomics, many methods that allow us to ask much more precise questions about the patient and the treatment. We also have new types of data about people. So not only is the genome available as a tool that we can use to tailor treatment, but there are many other aspects. The microbiome, which is the collection of microorganisms in and on the human body. The metabolome, which is the collection of chemicals within the human body. The epigenome, which is the modifications of the genome that occur often within a person's lifetime. These will all come to play in precision medicine. Even though the early tool that we're focusing on is genomics, we're going to be using many, many tools in the future that describe the full complexity of human individuality. We also have existing research cohorts that have been developed at UCSF, UC San Francisco, the Geisinger Clinic, Mayo Clinic, and many, many other universities and clinics across the country. Those cohorts give us enormous volumes of data about people over often a very long period of time. And it's that kind of intense data analytical approach that will form the basis for precision medicine. So one of the changes that I think has already been mentioned that's worth noting is the change in sequencing capacity. And it's not just the capacity, it's the cost. So when the first human genome was done, it took apparently approximately $22 million to complete the sequence. Today, it takes somewhere between $1,000 and $3,000 to complete a human genome sequence, and now it can be done in a day, not years. Electronic data is another source of power that we have to use in precision medicine. The electronic health record is going to be one of the central tools to precision medicine, which is probably many people here have experienced, the way that data can be stored about individuals by their physicians. 10 years ago, there were only about 20% of providers used electronic health records. Today, we're approaching 90%. That's a big jump and gives us the tools to use on a much broader population of Americans. Computing power over the same period has increased 16-fold and continues to increase. And the use of smartphones has increased from about 1 million a decade ago to about 160 million today, which is well more than half the population. And all of those will provide tools, with smartphones being now having the ability to collect data on the individual and transmit it to a common database. So we want to capitalize on those gains. And so proposed in the president's fiscal year 16 budget are four elements. First are the cancer trials. This is continuation and expansion of work that the National Cancer Institute has begun and has been incredibly successful and yielded tremendous insight into cancer. We're hoping that this expansion will enable more tailoring of treatment to cancer genotype, more liquid biopsies so that the liquid biopsies that Dr. Baselga mentioned can be used on all kinds of cancers, and ultimately overcoming or even reducing the appearance of resistance. Many cancers become resistant to treatment, and a real concern is avoiding that in the first place so that we don't have to switch treatments to find one that works. There's also an emphasis on pediatric cancers, which are possibly an understudied group of cancers, and certainly very hard to study for a variety of reasons. The second area of the budget proposal is to develop a large national cohort of at least 1 million, probably more, Americans who will volunteer their data to be used in the analysis that makes the groundwork of precision medicine. There is a process going on right now led by the NIH and the White House to figure out what that cohort will be and what will make it unique, what characteristics will be selected among the people who are part of the cohort, and then what will be studied. One of the things that will differentiate this cohort from many of the others that have been developed is that it will be a healthy cohort. It will be a whole spectrum of people who have every level of healthfulness or disease, so it won't be selected for a particular disease group. That will give us the tools to build the database and then ultimately the analytical tools to begin to associate disease and health with many different parameters, not only the individual's genome, but all the other aspects that I mentioned before, microbiome, metabolome, epigenome, and even mobile health data. The third area is to try to address the very knotty problem of making electronic health records interoperable. These have sprung up from many different companies that have provided them, and physicians find that they can't sometimes even communicate from their offices to the hospital with the same patient's records because the systems don't talk to each other. And so we have a really tremendous informatics and data management team at the White House that is working with NIH and the Office of the National Coordinator at HHS to try to figure out some computerized ways of tackling this problem and being able to group electronic health records together across different platforms. And finally, we're taking a look at regulatory policies. The FDA is very eager to protect patient safety while also facilitating new innovations. And so we're taking a look at some of the policies that have been raised as either needed or perhaps excessive that could be modified to increase innovation and also protect patient rights. Another area that the White House is working on in particular is leading an effort to examine patient privacy. And this becomes a major challenge, as you can imagine, with the movement of data from an individual's health record to some common database. And if researchers are going to have access to the data, we have to be concerned about who else might have access. Our experience is the patients that we've spoken to with stakeholder groups and other kinds of interactions is that the patients are more concerned about their data being used in precision medicine and used to help other people, perhaps with similar diseases, than they are about the privacy. But we need to anticipate what the privacy issues are up front. So we have a group of ethicists and physicians and researchers and citizens all looking at that problem. And they have just developed a set of principles of what are the key elements of privacy that we need to respect and adhere to as we develop the Precision Medicine Initiative. And finally, the White House has an initiative on data standards. This is an issue that will determine how well we can mix and match data from different trials, from different sites, different facilities, and in different kinds of electronic health records. And so we're trying to figure out what standards are needed in order to make sure that the maximum number of patients can participate in a precision medicine cohort. So the next milestones that you'll probably hear about will be the defining of the 1 million members of the national cohort, and we're targeting to have a plan from NIH by October 1st. Then we'll be pending, of course, budget approval. We'll be launching the cancer trials through the NCI, and then we'll be publishing and getting reactions to the privacy principles that have been developed. And there's a lot more that you can anticipate. So hopefully we'll have another chance to talk.
Thank you, Dr. Handelsman. We all look forward to working with you in this initiative, which, as you say, is not new, but we're dialing it up. We're dialing it up. So I have now a question for Dr. Baselga. Do you foresee a time when sequencing a patient's tumor's DNA is standard medical practice across the U.S.? And what are some of the hurdles we should be aware that need to be overcome now?
So, Carlos, this is an important question, and I did address it somewhat in my presentation. I think it's going to be useful, it's going to be important, and I think it should be offered to patients, at least right now, with advanced disease, because it might help inform them on the best treatment and also in some of the potential outcome that they might have. The challenge is cost, but as has been mentioned by Dr. Handelsman, the cost is decreasing very rapidly. There's going to be some issues on the different platforms, so we need to make sure that they are standardized somehow, but this is going to be easier than with other methodologies, just because to sequence genes is quite robust. But the calls are going to be something that we need to standardize the informatics part to that. But I think it is absolutely doable, and we should be very aggressive at pursuing this goal.
Thank you. And Dr. Handelsman, one quick question for you. How do these efforts in the U.S. compare to those being conducted around the world?
We've done an analysis of the other precision medicine efforts, with some of the leading ones being in Britain and China. And we've found that we're larger and we're more aggressive in our goals in precision medicine than any of the other countries are so far. Now, that doesn't mean that some of them won't try to catch up with us. One of the most interesting examples we discovered was one in Estonia, where they had to build a computer system sort of from scratch when the Soviet Union broke up. And so they had the luxury of starting from scratch and doing it right in this modern era. And so all of their health records are compatible with each other. And any physician that has access can get into essentially any citizen's records and do an analysis, usually with them being updated weekly. So we have a pretty high standard to tackle there, but of course we have a much more complex citizenry.
Yeah, well, thank you. Clearly this is going to change the way medical schools educate the students. I mean, this is amazing. So I'd like to go to the next speaker, Dr. Elizabeth Blackburn. She's a Maurice Hertzstein Professor in Biology and Physiology in the Department of Biochemistry and Biophysics at the University of California in San Francisco and former president of the AACR. In 2009, Dr. Blackburn received the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for her discovery of the enzyme telomerase and the fact that short sequences of DNA known as telomeres located at the end of chromosomes protect the integrity of our DNA during cellular replication. This monumental discovery has led to many studies involving whether or not telomerase may be used to counteract cancer and other age-related diseases. Dr. Blackburn?
Thank you, Carlos, and thank you, everybody, for being here. As Carlos said, my name is Elizabeth Blackburn, and I'm a scientist at the University of California, San Francisco, which Congresswoman Speier alluded to earlier, so I feel extremely fortunate. And I wanted to tell you a little bit more, sort of focused in, I thought, a little bit more about the experiences I've had, and in particular, how my fundamental research, it started very fundamental, how it started to tell us about cancers, you know, our common enemy, and how it's poised to be used now in new ways for patients who have cancers. Now, you're wondering about my accent, so I always have to get this out of the way. I was born and I grew up in Tasmania, Australia. That's very far away in the Southern Hemisphere. I came to the United States in the mid-1970s after I'd done my PhD training in the UK. And I simply came because I knew that it was here in the US that the world's most exciting science was being done, and that I would have the opportunity to fulfill my passion and my vision of doing the best science that I possibly could. And it's really clear to me that it's simply because of the NIH that that dream of mine was fulfilled more than I could have ever hoped for. So my research was, as was alluded to, it was to understand what goes on in cells. And I have to say, you know, I felt like an astronaut exploring unknown worlds then, excepting these worlds were not galaxies. These were the tiny microscopic molecular world of the chromosome ends. And I discovered, really surprisingly at the time, that these ends, and they're called telomeres, right? They're like protective tips at the ends of your shoelaces. I don't know how many of you are wearing shoelaces, but take a look down at them, and that's what they are. And they powerfully protect the ends of chromosomes, and that's carrying that genetic information that we've been hearing about that is so crucial for the health of cells, but also so crucial because it goes wrong, for example, so badly in cancers. And that protection is lost if those chromosome ends, those protective tips at the ends of the shoelaces that you can think of as like chromosomes, if they wear down, which they do in many of our body cells as they age, and that can actually cause cancers because the genetic material is no longer as well protected as it needs to be. And it's now many, many scientists to work across the US and across the world that's led to this discovery that this wearing down really does happen in us, in our bodies. So I want to tell you just two things we've learned from this research. Just give you a couple of examples, because they do relate to this newer understanding of cancer, and that is that we do understand that the whole individual has to be treated when we treat cancers. Because for fighting cancers, how your body reacts, as you'll hear about from Dr. Ruman, how your body reacts is as important as how the cancer cells themselves behave. They're both clearly very important. So first, we did discover that one's immune cells, telomeres, they get worn down faster if somebody is under chronic psychological stress, and that includes severe prolonged depression. Depression is very common, in fact. And this wearing down, to put it simply, makes the body more inflammatory. And that prevents the immune system from properly protecting against various diseases, but particularly in this case, protecting against cancers. So, well, what did that finding have to do with cancers? Well, so I want to tell you something striking and use an example, which is how measuring just the wearing down, the shortness of the immune cell telomeres, just telomeres from a blood sample, and depression, measuring depression, is a very simple and dramatic example and an illustration of the principle that Dr. Handelsman has told you about, the principle of precision medicine, as you can apply it in cancer in this case. And remember, precision medicine, it means combining different pieces of information to better predict what will happen to, in this case, a cancer patient, as well as, of course, how to best treat their cancer. Now, a study from MD Anderson in Houston was with bladder cancer patients. So they'd all been freshly diagnosed with bladder cancer, right? So here they all are, lots of different people. Now, if at the time of their diagnosis, if they weren't depressed, and if they had long telomeres, or if they were depressed, but they had long telomeres, or they had short telomeres, but they weren't depressed. Okay, so in other words, if they had one or neither, okay, after about 2.5 years, only about 17% had died. So that's only about 1/6. Of course, that's too many, but that was how many had died. If they had both short telomeres and depression at the time of diagnosis, this is how many had died after 2.5 years. So I think you can see the difference. It was actually 55%. It was over half. Now, after 5 years, that's a critical time for seeing if the cancer is going to come back or not. So it's an important time point. In this study, if you only had one or other, depression or short telomeres or neither, about this many had died, about a third of people had died. So those were the ones who, a sixth had died and now a third had died at about 5 years. Okay, but of the ones who had both, they all had. So this is the message in just a simple example of what is the power of precision medicine, how you increase your predictive information by combining, in this case, it's just two simple pieces of information. In this case, it's about the body. And of course, this is not the only example by any means. So there's a big difference between what I just showed you here and here, right? And so knowing just this alone could tell a bladder cancer patient and their doctor what to expect more precisely from the time of diagnosis. And therefore, that could guide their treatment. And we can't ignore the implications of such information. So for a patient, we would need to find out, for example, if improving their depression or, you know, bulking up the telomeres with physical exercise, for example, you know, we don't know. But will that help the patient survive the cancer? This is what we know. So there's so much that needs to be explored, and this sort of thing needs to be explored in the much wider sense of precision medicine and all its ramifications in other cancers. I just gave you this very simple example of why knowing something is very strongly predictive in certain cases if you know what to ask for. So I hope I've given you just this very brief taste of one way what began as really fundamental research. My fundamental research is now poised to be used in all sorts of new ways that we didn't expect to find at all. Believe me, we didn't expect to find this for diseases, and we didn't expect to find this for patients with cancers. There's just so much more that's going on. And I think we're truly at the beginning of our hopes for realizing all of what precision medicine can do. And I want to return to the NIH. I mean, this is how this began, and this is so important for how it can continue to really make some difference and not just let all of this tremendous amount of information go to waste as one fears it might do without being able to be supported to keep it strong and vibrant.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Blackburn. I think that for that great example of how the host can really affect cancer biology, which is something that gets at the core of what precision medicine is going to do by looking not only at tumors, but also that germline DNA that we will have. So one quick question for you. There's a lot of concern about the next generation of scientists and challenges facing young investigators in a time of tight budget. And again, how important do you think, can you remind us, or how important do you think, how important is that funding for that catalytic moment, that early start, young investigators who, you know, if they don't have a signal that that we want them to do this, I mean, they may never come back.
Yes, for biomedical research, nothing can replace the NIH, not industry, not private money. The scale and the breadth of what the NIH can do is crucial. And for young investigators to be able to have a process in which you can compete, and you do indeed compete, and I competed when I was young, but I knew that about a third of grants would get funded. And so you competed honestly for grants, and you knew there was a good chance if you could do good research, put up a good case, there would be some hope. And so I think the real worry now is that young investigators look at the very daunting lack of funding within the NIH, and they're smart people, and they're tremendously good at science and passionate about science, but they don't see that. They're very discouraged often. And sometimes there's tremendous mechanisms that the NIH has had for trying to encourage the more junior scientists. But science is not just, you know, 3 to 5 years and then it's all over. Science really requires years, and often the funding then gets very hard after that time. And so people look ahead and think, well, you know, if I'm going to be dropped down a hole after 5 years because I can't get funding, they won't keep doing it. And I look at our tremendously talented students and postdoctoral fellows, and I'm seeing this kind of thing happening, and it's truly a waste of the tremendous investment that has happened. And, you know, I think I've made my point.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. So next speaker is Dr. Joan Brugge. She's the director of the Ludwig Center in the Department of Cell Biology at Harvard Medical School and a former AACR board member. Her pioneering research has centered on understanding how oncogenes induce cancer cell growth, invasion, and metastasis. She has discovered various proteins that are involved in cancer development and has characterized the role of the area surrounding tumors known as the tumor microenvironment in the promotion of cancer spread. Dr. Brugge is currently investigating how tumor cells outsmart targeted therapies with the hope of identifying novel drug combinations for cancer patients with advanced disease. Dr. Brugge?
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's really great to see such a strong interest in cancer research. I'm going to start by saying, giving away my age, which is something I think people my age generally try to avoid, but I need to make a specific point with that. And that is that I started cancer research actually the same year that President Nixon launched the war on cancer, which was 1970. And my personal entree into cancer research was motivated by the death of my 21-year-old sister due to an untreatable malignant malignant brain tumor. So at that time, I was in college. I started doing research in a lab. I was both empowered by Nixon's charge and also very optimistic that the funding that was earmarked for cancer research would lead to cures in short order. And I think we were all influenced by the poliovirus initiative, which was enormously successful in the development of vaccine, which eliminated the disease. But as you've heard, we soon learned in early stages of the research that cancer is not a simple disease like polio. It's not an, it's in, it may be, there may be viruses that provoke it, but it's not due to, exclusively to that virus. And what we found, in fact, as you heard, is that cancer is caused by mutations in our own DNA. So this posed a totally different type of challenge in developing treatments. It wasn't like an infectious disease that you could develop a vaccine or an antibiotic. We also learned that each tumor contains not just one mutation, but as you heard from Dr. Baselga, contain many mutations. So there are many targets that that are driving, are there many genes that are driving these cancers? And then later, we found an even more daunting finding that every tumor, again, as you heard from Dr. Baselga, contains its own set of mutations. So each breast tumor, for instance, every one of the tumors is distinct in the combination of different mutants that they contain. So this made the problem even more complex. And I have to say that, you know, these revelations, as well as the other research that was going on in cancer has basically caught the discoveries that have been made have constantly changed our perspective of this disease because we keep uncovering these layers of complexity. But also they have revealed the underpinnings of cancer and its enormous complexity. So as you've heard from Dr. Baselga and Dr. Arteaga, this fundamental understanding of cancer has enabled pharmaceutical companies to develop remarkably effective drugs, and the successes that you've heard about have really heralded a brighter future for cancer patients with multiple types of cancer. So what I want to tell you about today are some of the what we've learned from the about the complexity of cancer based on the initial successes that have in the development of drugs that target specific alterations in tumors. And I'd like to use the illustration shown on the next slide. Okay. So this image on the left is a patient with advanced melanoma. So you can see it's actually pretty somewhat upsetting picture because this patient has so many distant metastases. So this particular the tumors within this particular patient had a mutation in a gene called BRAF. And a company called Plexicon had developed a drug that specifically inhibited the mutant form of this cellular protein. So the clinicians that were in charge of this patient treated this patient with this Plexicon drug as part of a clinical trial. The patient returned after 15 weeks of being treated on the drug, and you can see in the middle image that there was basically almost miraculous shrinkage of the tumors. And so the patient and the physician treating the patient were elated. However, the elation was short-lived because, as you can see in the slide on the right, when the patient returned in 8 weeks, essentially almost every one of those metastatic tumors had grown back. So I think that this illustrates two really important points. One is that we've been enormously successful in identifying the alterations driving these tumors, and the pharmaceutical company's been enormously successful in inhibiting those mutant proteins. But what the slide on the right shows is that we still have a significant challenge because the tumors are able to become resistant to the tumor. So over time, even when these patient was still being treated with the tumor, they became resistant. So I'm sure you're beginning to wonder, so what happened to this patient? How did those tumors, which initially dissolved, what made them come back? And what we've learned in the field is that the overwhelming evidence, at least, suggests that the basis for this phenomenon of tumor relapse is due to variations in the sensitivity of individual cells within the tumor to these different drugs. And I'm just going to illustrate that again on the next slide here. So on the left side are either lung tumors or ovarian tumors, and they're colored in a different way because, as you heard from Dr. Baselga, every one of those tumors has a different set of mutations. And basically, the whole precision medicine initiative was based on that finding that each patient has a different set of mutations. It's almost like a fingerprint. But what we've learned more recently, just in the last 5 or so years, is that if you take an individual's patient's tumor and look inside, there is enormous variation in the genetic alterations in that one tumor. So in the illustration I have here, you can consider that every one of those tumor cells in that one tumor contains different sets of genetic alterations, just like the tumors. And so, and it turns out that each one of those tumor cells that has different mutations has different sensitivity to these targeted therapies. And so, for instance, if you treat this tumor with a drug that targets something like the BRAF protein, what happens is that the green cells, which are the most resistant, stay alive and are not killed, whereas all the other cells survive. So you can imagine what would happen here. Say, for instance, for that patient, the green cells are still alive. They're able to grow. They expand. And then you get the regrowth of that tumor. So basically, the challenge now is to develop strategies in order to be able to eliminate those proportion of tumor cells that are resistant to the original therapy. So What I've told you about is that this variation in drug sensitivity is due to genetic differences in the genetic alterations within the tumor cells. But we can add a whole nother layer of variation that contributes to the variation in drug sensitivity in addition to these genetic alterations. And what we've learned is that tumors are not just composed of tumor cells, but a whole array of different normal cells as well as tumor cells. So these normal cells are recruited to the tumor. And it turns out that each one of these, does it not go backwards? Ah. It's not going backwards. Ah, there we go. Okay. The pointer doesn't work. So it turns out that each one of these different types of normal cells that are resident within the tumor produce factors that confer resistance to the tumor. So the reason why we have the different colors of the tumor cells is not only due to the genetic variation, but because of factors that are secreted, for instance, by the blood vessels that are recruited to the tumor, to the immune cells which are recruited to the tumor, or these connective tissue cells that you see in there. So we now are thinking about tumors as being an ecosystem that's composed of a whole set of different populations of cells, just like we have different ecosystems in nature. And what I think what the challenge is really to bring together scientists that are working on all these different components of the tumors, as well as mathematical modelers, systems biologists, immunologists, in order to cross-fertilize to really figure out how we can overcome this problem. And there's enormous success, as you'll hear about from Dr. Rubin, in immunotherapy. Many of these tumor cells that are resident in the tumors are basically been turned off by the tumor microenvironment. And immunologists have figured out ways to wake up those tumor cells so they can start the immune cells so they can start destroying those. So I think that there is significant progress being made in meeting this challenge, but there's still a lot of work that needs to be done because of the overwhelming number of different types of factors that contribute to this variation in drug resistance. So I think that at this juncture, it's really critical to enhance NCI funding. Otherwise, there's going to be a significant delay in realizing the benefits from the investment in cancer at a time when there's about to be a virtual tsunami of cancer from the baby boomers as they reach 65. So a fact that you may not be aware of is that the incidence of cancer in individuals 65 years and older is 10 times that of individuals 10 times younger. So with the increase in baby boomers, there's a huge increase in tumor incidence. And then I just want to make one last point, and that really deals with an issue of kind of the labor market in cancer research. Just at a time when we need to bring in the brightest young minds in cancer research, there's a brain drain away from cancer. And I think one thing that illustrates it is a comment from one of the really great postdocs in my lab that's going to be starting her lab next in the fall. What she said to me was she was starting to draft her first grant, and she said she's taking out the cancer projects from the grant so that she can send them to the General Medicine Institute of the National Institute of Health because the funding levels in the NCI are so poor. So she felt that her grant would have a much better chance. So I think that's just one illustration. We need to keep these bright young scientists in cancer research to meet the challenges that I told you about today and to both prevent and treat cancer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joan. Thank you very much. That patient with melanoma that you showed, clearly the drug vemurafenib did change the natural history of the disease, albeit for a short time. So you think, had that drug been used earlier and perhaps in combination, would it have been, the outcome would have been different?
Well, that's a good question. So would treatment with verafenib earlier led to a better outcome? I was speaking about this issue actually with Dr. Baselga earlier, and what he's done a trial with this same drug in patients with both melanoma and other treatments. And treatment with this drug alone, they're seeing resistance even in earlier stages than this cancer patient. However, that's not to say that even much earlier detection before a lot of genetic alterations had appeared, I think there's promise that there's less of a chance of that occurring. And then in addition, some of the treatments where these targeted therapies are being used is after the original tumor is removed, where there's no evidence of metastasis, and that perhaps there's just, you know, small little foci of tumors, of tumor cells in different parts of the body, it's very likely that the single treatment or combination treatments would be able to eliminate those, because before they've become, you know, before the tumor burden has become
correct.
Too great.
Yeah. This is very reminiscent of the drugs that José talked about, Herceptin and Perjeta. These drugs are, when given to patients with metastatic breast cancer, they palliate the disease, they prolong life, but they don't cure. However, when we moved into the adjuvant setting to treat micrometastatic disease immediately after surgery, they really induce significant cures. So I think that we need to treat early, treat combinations. But again, this example underscores how much more we can do together. So thank you very much. The next speaker is Dr. Eric Rubin. He's the Vice President of and Therapeutic Area Head of Oncology Clinical Development at Merck Research Laboratories. In this role, Eric oversees the company's translational cancer research activities as they relate to cancer drug design and development efforts. Dr. Rubin is revered for his efforts in leading the development of the first anti-PD-1 antibody, pembrolizumab, which received approval from the FDA for use in patients in 2014. This first of its kind immunotherapy was approved for the treatment of melanoma that has spread throughout a patient's body. This drug also assists with improving the chances of a patient responding to treatment. In addition to being effective against skin cancer, this drug is now showing promise for the treatment of various other cancers. Eric?
Thanks, Carlos, and it's great to be here representing industry. So as you've heard, there is a new transformative weapon in the war against cancer, and that's immunotherapy, particularly immunotherapy that involve checkpoint inhibitors. And this really involves using the body's own immune system to fight the cancer. So the interesting part is that these are treatments that actually don't directly target the cancer, unlike the ones you've heard about before. They're actually manipulating the immune system, and I'll get into the mechanism in a little bit. This stems from a basic research that was done 30 years ago in NIH-funded laboratories by people such as Dr. James Allison and Dr. Gordon Freeman, who were interested in fundamental aspects of human immunology. And as they were looking at what controls the normal immune function, they recognized that there were proteins that they called checkpoints that basically were there to keep the immune system in check. What happens commonly in cancer is that cancer cells use this. They actually upregulate these proteins, and that allows them to evade the immune system. So what we find in some cases, if we biopsy a cancer, we'll see a lot of immune cells present, but they're not doing anything because they're turned off by these checkpoint proteins. So with this information, many companies began to pursue mechanisms to target this pathway known as checkpoint inhibitors, and most of these are highly specific monoclonal antibodies that block the interaction between these checkpoint inhibitors and thus potentially enable turning back on the immune system. So there are now three of these checkpoint inhibitors that are approved. The first one was in 2011, and it targets a checkpoint protein known as CTLA-4. The drug's called ipilimumab, was developed by Bristol-Myers Squibb, and it showed activity in melanoma, approved for the treatment of melanoma. More recently, a second checkpoint protein known as PD-1 has been of interest, and this is the one that the Merck drug pembrolizumab targets, as well as a related drug known as nivolumab, from Bristol-Myers Squibb, which is also approved for melanoma and for squamous cell lung cancer. The remarkable part of these immune treatments is that they are quite different from prior treatments that have been mentioned by Dr. Brugge, is that it actually seems to be hard for cancer cells to become resistant. So the amazing thing is that while not everybody responds, the people that do respond have very prolonged responses, now in some cases going on well beyond 2 years. And so these are patients with highly advanced metastatic cancer, and so this is quite remarkable that this happens. And the belief which is being studied is that even though the cancer cells can become resistant by mechanisms shown by Dr. Brugge, that the immune system can adapt to this, so it's not a static drug. So the cancer can change, but so can the immune system, keeping the cancer in check. And so this breakthrough treatments are now being pursued in multiple cancer types, in more than 30 cancer types, and I think we're going to see additional advances beyond melanoma and squamous cell lung cancer. Another part I wanted to mention that relates to precision medicine demonstrates how precision medicine is important in this field. This is recent work involving colon cancer. So in early studies with these drugs, one of the cancers that didn't seem to respond well was colon cancer. In one of the early studies, there were 19 patients with colon cancer who were treated with an anti-PD-1 antibody, and none of the patients responded. So with this, it was felt that for reasons that weren't clear, these drugs just simply didn't work in colon cancer. However, that was reversed recently in work shown at the recent ASCO meeting, as well as published in the New England Journal of Medicine. And the story, this is work done by investigators at Johns Hopkins in collaboration with Merck. And the story actually, again, begins about 20 years ago in work that, at the time, I think no one would have thought would have been relevant to the use of an immunotherapy. So again, shows how the importance of basic research funded by the NIH. And this is research from the laboratories of Dr. Vogelstein, Bert Vogelstein at Hopkins, as well as Richard Klodner at the Dana-Farber, that studied mechanisms of the genetic mechanisms for the cause of colon cancer. And what they found was that in about 15% of patients, this related to mutations in DNA repair proteins. These are known as mismatch repair proteins or genes, and they're responsible for correcting mutations that could otherwise lead to cancer. Some patients, because these genes themselves are mutated, they're not able to do that. And so in pre-malignant states, the colon tissue can acquire many, many mutations, and this drives the cancer. And the cancers can be recognized by this by a relatively simple test known as a test that looks for microsatellite instability. Microsatellites are another short stretch of DNA, not telomeres, but again, a short stretch of DNA that becomes highly repeated in cases where these mismatch repair genes are mutated, and again, can be recognized by a test. So the researchers at Hopkins, Dr. Vogelstein, Diaz, and others, they asked, well, patients that have very high levels of these mutations, they might actually be good patients to treat with an immunotherapy because their cancers, because they carry this high mutational burden, will have lots of new proteins or antigens that can be recognized by the immune system, and thus they might actually be good patients to treat. So they asked us to collaborate in a trial which began about a year ago in patients where they specifically looked for patients with this mismatch repair deficiencies. And unlike the prior result, in this case, 40% of patients responded to the drug. And again, these are, at this point, seem to be the same types of durable responses that we've been seeing in other patients treated with the drug. So there were, in contrast, they did treat patients with colon cancer who did not have this deficiency, and there were no responses. They also treated a handful of patients with non-colon cancer who had this genetic defect, and these patients also responded. So I think this demonstrates how the impact of precision medicine. It's taken a disease previously thought not to be responsive to a treatment and shown how if you identify the right patient, it actually can be highly effective. I think is a nice example of both the importance of funding of basic research as well as precision medicine. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Again, another example of how basic science led to the discovery of checkpoint inhibitors, development of drugs that are now inducing responses in patients that we have never seen before, I promise you. So this is amazing. So a question for you is, how can you share with us, how is it that funding of academia by NIH and NCI, how does that, and the support of the FDA, how do those things would affect the pharmaceutical industry?
Yeah, so I think I've given this example of the mismatch repair as a really nice example of, I think, of how support of basic science is beneficial to the pharmaceutical industry. This is probably studies we would not have done. Again, no clear link to a drug at that particular point, but with a collaboration can quickly lead to identifying treatments, again, that are effective for a particular type of cancer. You mentioned FDA. I also note that that many of these anti-PD-1 drugs have been designated as breakthrough treatments. I do think that in both the Merck case as well as other companies, that having that designation has enabled interactions with the FDA that have speeded development of the drug and approval. There are now many more of these breakthrough treatments, though, and my sense is that the FDA is becoming quite stretched thin to enable these types of frequent interactions with industry that will allow them to enable these rapid advances. And so I think that some of the work in 21st Century Cure and others that will help support the FDA is going to be very important for the pharmaceutical industry.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So now I'd like to open the floor for questions. I hope that some of these presentations have been informative to you as they have been to me. And I like to wonder whether you have any questions for any of the presenters, please.
I'm Jean Alport from the Prevent Cancer Foundation. Thank you so much for being here today and giving us all the amazing background you did. Question sort of off topic, but only because you mentioned it. We have, for the past 30 years, funded early career researchers. And we are really concerned that they're going to go back home. Is there anything that we can do as we're trying to increase the budget for NCI and NIH to keep them here and to keep their talent going and to bring more people into the fold?
And Dr. Blackburn, you want to address that?
One immediate thing maybe to think about the issue that I referred to, where the NIH and the NCI have been very good about really trying to get junior, beginning researchers into the granting system where they can start to do their important work, only to have a situation where it becomes then much harder for them to continue. I would look at these talented people and push funding, forward, because I think getting past that sort of big hole might really be tremendously helpful for then getting the momentum that they would then be able to be much more competitive and, be able, because we all compete for grants. And this is really important. It's not just sort of lying around getting money thrown at you. People compete, and the best ones win because there's a very, very good review system at the NIH. And so I think you could tie in with excellent review systems. AACR has a very good model of how they provide their scientists' expertise for grants, which are not funded by the NIH, but by private organizations. And so I think that might be an area to think about. Could be very, very impactful.
It's also important to be reminded that it's not only young investigators the ones that are hurting. It's also those investigators who are a little bit post-young, who are doing their first grant renewals, who are, in that upslope.
Right, that's the
stage. And again, that's also a constituency that we have to pay attention to. Any other questions?
That was the one I meant.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yes, my name is Madeline. I'm a student, a pharmacy student. I have a question as far as the discovery and how it, of new cancer research and how it applies to a clinic, for example. So all of your research showed great progress as far as how cancer works. We know some mechanisms as to how we can treat it, but as far as from a diagnostic end, early cancer detection can be very, very important in saving lives. As far as from a diagnostic perspective, how standard are our treatments, and how far is there a lag, or is it one of those chicken and the egg where you really need to advance the diagnostic tools in order to treat these cancers?
So you want to do that, since we talked about next-gen sequencing and all
yeah,
that?
So. Diagnosis is incredibly important because the more you understand what is driving a tumor, a better choice of a better understanding and a better therapist you can propose to the patient. I think the great example again here is HER2. So when we began to develop HER2 therapies, we were treating patients that had tumors with multiple levels of expression. And we realized down the line that only those that had lots of HER2 were responding to these therapies. So if you have a diagnostic test that is not accurate, you're going to be mistreating patients. You are not going to be providing them with the best therapies or what they need. So it's key. So I think that we need to spend money early on at making a better diagnosis, clearly. And perhaps what we could do is do less testing later on when it doesn't matter. So, you know, if you look at the amount of overuse that we have with imaging techniques and lab tests and so on, later on in patients with very advanced disease where there is nothing you can do to help, we should really shift our cost to have better and more accurate diagnostic tools early on when you can save lives. So that's a great topic for discussion, and we just created a department at our place precisely to have these discussions.
John, you want to add something? No? Sorry, I thought you were grabbing the microphone. Yeah, and also, please, we also have Dr. José also mentioned NCI match. That's another example of, again, trials that go that recruit patients based on a diagnostic test. And also, we're all now pretty much comfortable with the idea that any drug has to be developed with a diagnostic attached to it. The idea is let's spend a lot of time before approval of that trial. So once that drug is deployed, we know what patient to treat. So any other questions?
I'm Devin Satter with Congressman McKinley's office. West Virginia has the highest mortality rate of cancer. Very rural state. You're all from urban areas. What do you say about rural medicine when you're talking about southern West Virginia? These people have no access to a cancer treatment center. We're funding these fundamental, incredible scientific achievements. How do we make it available to Americans?
Well, I'm not too far from you. I work in Tennessee. Okay, so we're neighbors. And again, that's I know what you're talking about. I think there are NCI designated centers in most states, if not all. Yeah. Well, we need one there then. But I think, or maybe other cancer centers in the area, part of their mission is to reach out again to some of the hospitals in that and network with them in order to educate the public again about the fact that, yeah, cancer, as I said, is no longer an automatic death sentence. It's possible that those people there don't know that. Okay, so I think we need to spread the word. But I know maybe others have comments here, but it's a very difficult problem.
If I make a comment. The problem is that you have pinpointed is incredibly important, and it applies to West Virginia. It applies to many other states, New York to begin with as well. 80% of cancer care, 80% of cancer care is given in small clinical practices. Our institution that is huge, we only have 13% of the market share in New York City. So basically, cancer care is delivered locally by physicians' offices or by small groups. And you are pointing to a very significant issue. We are making all these advances. Are we bringing them to the community early enough? Are we making sure that all American patients can benefit from this tremendous advantage? And it's upon us to do that. Now, I think that Dr. Handelsman made the comment already that the capacity to have information available through the implementation of IT systems in which we could have databases that would be open source available to everybody, and if we could make systems that would be easy to use, the ideal situation would be that a physician or a patient in any place in the country could access and see, you know, I have this kind of tumor, what's out there, what trials are available to me, what is the prognosis that I have, and so on. So I think the hope is that through open access information systems, we should be able to share all this data and make it available. That's one initiative. The other one is that we will need to create networks so that every small group can participate in networks of clinical trials or networks of therapies. But it's not easy, and I hear you. I mean, that's a big problem.
You touched on so much. You're talking about data and getting information out there. My in-laws live in West Virginia, live in a not so far out, that's about 5 hours away. There's no internet service to where they live. Mm-hmm. So when you talk about that, my cell phone works only in her kitchen. And yeah, I go off the grid when I go visit my mother-in-law, but there's no internet. Cell phones don't work, so what do we do to someone like that who lives in a community? There's a couple thousand people there with no internet service. So I'm not saying you're going to come up with the answer, but I'm just saying these are things that I would hope researchers are taking into account.
Absolutely.
So that we make sure that people that live in Philippi, West Virginia, have access to something like this.
Thank you for the question. Thank you very much. Please.
Hi, my name is Adea Sturkey. I am a biology major at Hampton University. And most other diseases, there's always a lot of big talk about prevention and assessing risk factors. How progressive and aggressive is research in the area of assessing risk factors for individuals who have, who may be at higher risk for developing cancer along the lines of family history or genomic information that has been done?
Dr. Handelsman, you want to handle that? I mean, I think that this reminds me of the 1 million precision medicine cohort and the efforts in that area, but there are many others going on that maybe can be illustrated.
There are many efforts that are attempting to find the complex of factors, and I think we heard an example today of where the interaction of factors can be more predictive than either one alone. That we hope will be part of the precision medicine cohort that we're developing. And we're also hoping that we'll be able to target lifestyle and more environmental factors that interact with the human genome. So it's not just the genome or the medical condition. It could be, the environment the person lives in. It could be the animals they're exposed to. It could be the microbes in their gut. By measuring all of those things and then analyzing the complex, we'll hopefully get much better models that will predict much earlier as disease is developing or maybe even before.
Could I just add to Dr. Handelsman's really important points and just say that, it is calculated about half of cancers are attributable to environmental, so-called lifestyle, but that includes a lot of things. Smoking is an obvious one, but there are other factors as well to which people really say about half of the cancers in the U.S. are attributable to these. So there's tremendous amount to be done, starting with education about that reality, even before we even get to the genome. There's a great deal to be done, and putting it all together, I think, could be even more powerful.
Yep.
I think it just hasn't been done because there's been such urgency in treating the cancers. They're so urgent that now, though, one has to step back and say, well, let's look at this tsunami, as Joan referred to, and say we've got to start doing both, preventing and treating the existing ones, and stopping the existing ones coming back.
Yeah, we all agree that preventing is going to be cheaper and easier than treating the late disease. The other thing could happen, too, is that as we identify individuals that may have a lot of risk factors, but that never develop cancer, there's going to be a lot of information in the genomics of those individuals about things that protected them, again, and we may find clues about prevention strategies from those individuals looking at this population research. And please.
Given the fairly compelling evidence of disparities like race and ethnicity in cancer, is any of your research taking those particular factors into account? It obviously implied when you talk about environment and lifestyle, but not yet. So I wanted to know if you want to comment further on the role of race and ethnicity.
Please.
The NIH has a number of projects that look at minorities and women and the role of their demographics in disease. The cohort that we're developing is going to be geared to trying to fill in some of the gaps, because some studies are done currently on different populations than the ones that suffer the most from that disease. So we're going to look and see which ones aren't being covered and then intensively sample those populations.
Thank you.
Chance of getting cancer is 10% higher, 10 times higher over 65. And I'm just wondering, looking around Congress, you see a lot of over 65-year-olds.
You
have
to be,
cancer.
Yeah.
Right.
So let's appeal to them.
Yeah, well, and so does that, because maybe there are more 65-plus people making these policies, do you think that could be an optimistic reason for improved cancer funding? Or is that just...
I open that to the people in the audience. You know, I think we all have to worry about it, not only for the individuals, but also the cost of the economy. You know, the health care to deal with this tsunami is really significant as well.
And then a follow-up on the 65-year-old question is about when you're treating older patients, are you concerned with curing the cancer or just prolonging a higher quality of life? How does that change your target treatments?
Leave it to the physicians.
Yeah. José, you want to address that?
So quality of life is paramount. You know, when you ask patients, and there are multiple studies that support that, whether they are willing to extend survival at any cost in terms of side effects and other related issues, the answer is absolutely no. One of the good things about these new therapies that we're talking about is that they have far less side effects than many of the classical therapies that we had until now. So when you look at the side effects that we see with the PD-1 antibodies that Dr. Rubin was talking about, they pale in comparison to the side effects that you see with chemotherapy. So quality of life is front and center. Patient-centered care and patient-centered decision-making is front and center, and you cannot dissociate one from the other.
And on the other hand, you know, go 20, 25 years forward, again, a 65 will not be an old age anymore. We'll be living longer. And there may be more cancer, but guess what? Most of them will be curable because it was picked up early. So... that's another way of looking at it. So one more question here.
Will there be any attention paid to physician education in the physician medicine initiatives?
Yeah, that's a great question, and we've been discussing it quite extensively. Even now, there are studies that show that physicians don't have the mathematical background to explain risk factors and degree of risk, or how the probability of having a disease if they have a positive test to their patients. And so we're very concerned about how quantitative the data from precision medicine are, because it's all predictions and correlations that will be given to patients. And so we're very concerned about that, and we're working with the training entities so that we hope we'll get it in early in the training. But we'll also have to do some retraining, because there are plenty of physicians out there who have been trained a long time ago.
Okay, I don't see any more hands going up, so thank you for being here, and thank you for your kind attention.